Good morning and welcome, friends, to this second day of our three-day event here. I'm very happy to see you all again. We talked about the path of the masters yesterday, what it means, why we need a perfect living master. And I mentioned the real reason for a perfect living master's coming into our spiritual life is to give us the experience of true unconditional love. That's the only way you can go beyond the mind. I have not been able to find any other way. That's the fundamental teaching of the path of the masters. That up to the level of the mind, which means to go to various centers of energy and awareness, mental awareness, we can go without the help of a perfect living master. And many teachers exist, many books exist, which gives you guidelines how to do it. And many people do it on their own. Not too many, but many do it. They need some guidance, how to go within, how to put your attention in the different centers, the six centers below the eyes, and the 12 centers behind the eyes. Six centers of energy. Sometimes they include a seventh center, the crown chakra. They're all energetic centers. They provide the energy for the human body to live and survive in a created physical world. And then there are the centers of awareness, which go backwards into the mind. And there are centers that go into our sense perceptions per se, which is our astral body. They give to our thoughts, which is our causal body. And then there are centers inside, which are spiritual centers, which only respond to love and devotion. So that is why the perfect living masters come for those who are seeking to go beyond the mind to their true home. They call Satchkhand, Satnam, Satlok, true home, true abode, a place from where everything originated. And that's the main reason. Now the question has been raised, and I get lots of text messages, emails on how to find a perfect living master. Finding a master, they say, is easy, because there are lots of masters. Great master used to say, there in India, at that time, when he spoke, there are more masters probably than disciples. It's a big, and in this country I saw it's a big trait. Lots of people are teaching us about spirituality, about God, about our true nature, our true identification with a soul or something higher. A lot of people talk about it. Perfectly, masters are very rare, because seekers who seek the ultimate truth are very rare. Most of the seekers, even those who go to perfect living masters, they are seeking some worldly comfort. They are seeking some intervention, divine intervention in physical life. We have a problem. We have emotional problems. Please help us. We have financial problems. Please help us. We have health issues. Please help us. Most of those who even go to these masters are asking for that. And then there are many who have developed psychic powers to actually help you in these things. And those yogis, masters also exist. But these are functions of masters who will not take you to a spiritual area which only love and devotion can take you. Many of these masters show great power and strength. But that power and strength is not the power of love. It's the power of their mind, power of their will. And they can affect our mind almost like a hypnotic suggestion. And we yield to hypnotic suggestions of many of these strong-willed people. This is not at all what a perfect living master does. A perfect living master does not say he is a master. He does not have to say it. He has not come to announce that he is a master. He's come to take the marked souls who have been marked earlier when destiny is formed back to the true home. We don't know if we are marked or not. We don't know when the time is there for us to go. But the programming is such that when we are ready to go, maybe after several million lifetimes spent in a cycle of birth and rebirth in physical and astral planes, when time is right, we begin to seek inside from our soul, not from our mind. When the soul seeks inside, it's a very different feeling. The mind does not understand what you are seeking. The mind tries to dismiss it. The mind tries to take you further into attachment to the world when the seeking is strong. A greater conflict is created in us when the seeking happens. But the seeking is for something that the soul wants. Soul does not recognize thoughts. Soul is not interested in thoughts. When it wants to use thoughts for staying in these three worlds of matter and mind, when it wants it to use, it uses the mind to think, to just get away with it, just to pass time with it. But soul seeks only love, joy, bliss, beauty, appreciation. That's what the soul needs. Soul needs instant awareness, not slow awareness that comes by thinking, reading and all that. And those characteristics of the soul are the characteristics of our true self. And when we discover our true self, we discover those things are intact. Everything else falls on the way. So that is why when we are ready with our seeking, a perfect living master appears in our life. And he will not say he's a master. If he says he's a master or claims to be a master, then don't forget that claim is an act of strong ego asserting itself. And when ego asserts itself, you are in a mental realm and not gone beyond the mind. Therefore, these perfect living masters come like ordinary people, sometimes more ordinary than ordinary people. And they come at a time when we are ready. Of course, they come for marked souls whose time has come for their particular master. Masters come in human form, like ourselves. Therefore, there's a limitation. How many people they can meet, how many souls they will interact with, they don't come to make a universal appeal to the world to come to them. They come to pick up marked souls, marked for them in their list. There can be several masters coming in different parts of the world, depending upon where the seekers are. Great master used to say, the number of such perfect living masters, even in the best of times, that means in Kali Yuga, which is the best of time for the more masters coming in, has never been more than what can be counted on the fingers of the two hands. He was giving almost 8 as a limit in the whole world of perfect living masters being present in this world. But masters, of course, many. I mentioned yesterday, it need not be that you have to search for a perfect living master. It's not possible. You cannot really identify a perfect living master. You have to be pulled by the love of a perfect living master. There are some obvious signs of a perfect living master. No perfect living master ever charges any fee or takes anything for his seva, for his disciples, period. If somebody is charging money for giving initiations, giving seva to the disciples to serve them, cannot be a perfect living master. They're very basic. He's come to give, not to take. Of course, he survives like other human beings, worked for it like other human beings, does his duties to his family, to his friends, to his job, exactly like we would do, like anybody else will do. Yet, in the midst of this, he'll try to give, not take. So his service is always free of charge. Secondly, he does not perform any public miracles. on the street to show to people who he is. He does lots of private miracles for the individual disciples, individual souls. They experience miracle after miracle. But if you go to a perfect living master, after a great miraculous thing that's happened and you know he did it, you go and say, "Master, what a wonderful thing you did." He said, "What? What did I do?" As if he knows nothing about it. He can be so human, like us. That's a very big characteristic, and I'll tell you the reason why this is so. Not only that they don't claim to be masters, they call themselves the servants of their masters and the servants of the people whom they serve. All perfect masters have said this. It's very amazing that they should all describe themselves as serving, as sevadars, as servants, as das of the masters and the master disciples. So that is why they have not shown their ego in any way by claiming something, which they might have, but they won't never claim it. Whatever they do, as it happens, they have their own master, and they give all the credit of what is happening to their own masters. My master, great master, Baba Sawan Singh, we told them such a good thing happened. He never said he did anything. He says Baba Jamal Singh did it. That was his master. Always gave credit to his master. And even though we argued with him, sometimes, "No, we saw you doing it," he says Baba Jamal Singh might have taken my form, or he might have given that impression to you. My master does everything. But the most important sign of a perfect living master is that he pulls us with an unconditional love, with no judgment whatsoever. Most masters judge us. Better be good people, better follow the rule, better be moral, better we do this. They lay down rules to follow. If you don't follow, sorry, you failed. With a perfect living master, you can never fail. It's a very unique distinction. You can never fail because you either pass or you learn more. You either succeed or learn more. There's no failure. So this is a very big difference. Sometimes we cannot feel that unconditional love very quickly, because we don't know they are so ordinary. I remember I told some friends of mine in school, I said, "You come and see my master, and he's a perfect master. I'm very convinced about it." And he came, he said, "He's just an ordinary man. Where's the mastery about him?" And yet after some time, he came again and again, became a nice disciple and said, "He's a perfect living master." There was one professor, intellectual professor, who used to come to great master and say, "Master, I don't believe anything you say. I have studied very hard. It is psychological play that you are putting up. You actually are preying on the minds of people and trying to tell them there are higher regions and all that. There are no such things. There is no proof at all. There being a Satchkhand, a true home, and there are other levels of consciousness, all made up stories." He said, "The truth is, this is the only life we have, and this is the only way we can live here." So great master said, "Yes, professor, we have a right to have our own experiences, our own ideas. What you are saying is your ideas. But I have a different experience, I have a different belief because of my experience. We have a right to disagree on these things. So I'm very happy that you expressed your opinion to me. Thank you." Next week, the professor was back again. "Hey, master, I don't believe anything you say, because there's no proof of it. Master said, yes, sir, you told me last week also. I agree that you have a certain opinion based on your studies, and that's all right. After a week, next weekend, he was back again. Great Master said, knew something new this time? He says, no, I've come to tell you that what you teach is fooling the people. There's no truth in this. Great Master said, don't you think you have said the same things twice to me earlier? You come again to tell me the same thing. I accepted what your view is. That's your view. Why do you come again to tell me? He said, Dad, I don't know why I come. I want to come. He became one of the finest disciples of Great Master. What was pulling him? Was a love that was defying his whole intellect and his whole understanding through the mind. Such is the power of Great Master's love. Such is the power of a perfect living Master's love. That's the secret. These perfect living Masters come just to pull us with their love, because love will take us beyond the mind. And they are operating when they are with us in human form from their true home, Satchikand, and not from the physical plane. That's, I should explain that, how they can operate when they're physical human beings, how they can operate from somewhere else. The reason is that this creation has been created in layers, layers which are different from each other. One can understand a little bit by referring to a dream state. When we are dreaming, we are also in a world, a dream world, and we move about in that. Some things are very similar to this world, some are unusual in dream worlds. They don't see them here, they can see in dreams. And many people see new things in dreams. It's a different world. Some scientists are today trying to understand if there really is another world somewhere which we go into during dreams. They're even studying that. Or is it just something stored up in our mind? And what looks new because it is not part of our current experience, but is built into our DNA molecules from past, from previous generations. They are studying this subject. But we know that the dream sequence of a dream world is different. When we wake up, that ends. A new world starts. So two levels of wakefulness or consciousness are distinct. Similarly, there are other levels of consciousness which are as distinct as waking up from a dream. The pure astral region, not the overlap, the pure astral region is a new world. And we have a new body with no weight, no matter, but all sense perceptions. It's a new level of consciousness. It was pre-created before the physical was created. If you want to know the timing, the order of creation, because these three worlds have been created in order of time. The astral plane is first created before physical plane comes into existence in our experience. The causal plane, where is the mind? The thoughts are assembled in the causal plane. There is no body. There are no sense perceptions. The mind can perceive directly. It's not split into seeing, hearing, touching, tasting. They all become one perception. And that's a different level of awareness. The spiritual realm, where we find we are a soul, and all this was just created for experience, time and space was created to put all these things in, is a different level of awareness. Our true home, which is totality, everything originates there, is happening there, is a different level of awareness. This creation has taken place in all these layers and different levels of experiences, different worlds, different levels of consciousness. When we go to our true home, we go through one step at a time. We can't be in two places together for the simple reason that we cannot take two places as real if they both coexist. Only one can be taken as real. If we were having a dream and also awake at the same time, they'll both look unreal. Dream is real when we are dreaming. We wake up, this is real because we're not dreaming anymore. Only one level remains one reality. We can only be at one reality at one time, not at two at the same time. That is why we are locked off from other realities, of other levels of consciousness. We only experience one level. Right now we are experiencing a physical reality. This is the only reality we are experiencing. The others is guesswork, imagination, memory, something else. But not an experience of reality. This is a reality. When we go to the next level, this will not be real. That alone will be real. This will disappear like a dream. When we go to the next higher, these lower ones disappear. That is why when a disciple is moving upwards, he can go through each level one after the other and come back one after the other, a series of experiences, but only one reality at a time. Even up to the spiritual region, you discover you are a soul, it's one level of reality. Everything else becomes illusion, unreal, dreamlike. But when you reach the top, true home, Satchkhand, when you reach the top is not a separate reality. Top is the creator of all realities, and therefore all realities exist at the top. And you can see all realities and hold them and be operating at all five realities. Perfect living masters have reached the top and they operate from there, and therefore they are operating simultaneously from all five levels. They know all five are created realities, all five are illusions, all five are made up, all five made up for a certain purpose. They know the whole thing. Does not mean only perfect living master do that. Anybody who reaches, any soul that reaches the true home gets the same experience and can be having the experience of all realities at the same time. It's a very big difference. The four stages create single realities. You can't overlap them. Fifth stage, our true home, all realities are originating from there and can be experienced simultaneously from there. So perfect living master is a human being here for us. He is also working at the astral plane for other souls. He is also working at the causal plane for some other souls. Also working for souls in the spiritual plane. And also operating everything from the singularity that exists in totality of consciousness, not the top consciousness, totality. That's why I call it totality of consciousness, not the highest consciousness. Big difference. That is why when we see a perfect living master operating in this physical world, he's operating from all levels, aware of them. We see his physical body, but we don't see his awareness. His awareness is of all levels. Therefore, he's performing a very unique service to the created souls who are marked to go back to the same level of experience that he comes with. And the best part is, the best part is when a perfect living master initiates a seeker, he guarantees that he will become the same as the master. Reach the same level. They say there are masters and they are gurmukhs. Gurmukhs are defined those who follow the master. Their mind is attached to the guru. The manmukhs, the mind attention is attached to the mind. They say a gurmukh, by the help of his master, can have the same experience as the master. Not less. Perfect living master don't promise anything less. Other masters can. Perfect living masters, when they initiate a soul in the physical body here, they guarantee that soul with that master will reach the true home, Satchkhand. It's a very big thing. It may take time. Many souls do not go directly to Satchkhand, they go to all different realities. Because we are still attached to the mind in physical reality. Our mind wants things outside, in the created reality outside. Astral plane, mind wants more experience of the created reality. And those are far more attractive and beautiful than the physical world. Many souls get stuck for 1,000 years or so after initiation at the astral plane. So when I mentioned that masters are taking care of other souls, they are their souls. Their souls initiated long ago. And they are still trying to go over the desires, fulfill something that could not be fulfilled here, and they are trying to fulfill there. They are also trying to pay off their karma that could not be filled up here, pay off there, the karma, which sometimes masters arrange. Same thing at the causal plane. The mental plane, same thing happens. So that is why the guarantee of a perfect living master, when they come and pick up, the guarantee has come because of an arrangement the soul has made before it ever came into this created world of the three worlds. This arrangement was made at that time. If we say there was a past, there is no past there. Now always pervades there. But if we say, if it was so bad here, we had to get trapped into time, trapped into the negative powers, trapped into all this. Why did we come? That's another question people ask. It would be a very legitimate question if we really came here. But the truth is, we never came anywhere. We're still there. If you go to sleep and have a dream, you don't go anywhere. But looks like you have gone somewhere. This is all created creation. Creation has been so placed that we feel we have come somewhere because of the reality of space and time. When we wake up, we are there. We have never left our true home. We have left the awareness, the knowledge of our true home. And when we say journey back from one level to another, it's just regaining the awareness of the wakeful state. Ultimately, we find we were there. We made all the plan how we will be able to get back from this fifth level of creation, the physical level, and we placed enough methods to get back. What are the methods? When we want to go back and we are tired of this, a perfect living master in human form will appear in our life. And he will give us instructions, we'll follow, and we'll think he's somebody else. We have made the arrangement. So when we go to the top, we find master and the soul were the same, which are all created to have the experience and go back with that experience to our true home. So a very remarkable, beautiful creation, the way it has been set up. To create reality is not easy. To create shadows and to create pictures is easy. But this is a series of realities, each more real than the other. That's amazing. So when we go back from one level to another, we are thinking that we are going, we are flying, we are going to various places. These are all experiences that we go through at different levels. Ultimately, we find that we were the creators, we are part of the creator. There was no separation. Separation was created to have a new experience. Then the question, why did we have this experience, was because consciousness has to be conscious of something. Otherwise, consciousness ceases to have any meaning. How can you be conscious with nothing to be conscious of? So that is why this is an experiment that consciousness has unlimited capacity to be conscious of anything. And this experimentation of consciousness being conscious of various types of experiences is generating this creation, this whole creation. It's very wonderful that the consciousness can be conscious. Anything what it becomes conscious of becomes reality. In our true home, descriptions have been given in several books that there are many souls, all dancing with joy, because that's a joyful place. Joyful bliss, all souls are there. And some souls only, a few of them. It's just to make a story, you can't make a story of timelessness, but we make a story that some souls, small proportion, one-tenth, say, of the total souls that were dancing around in good time, decided to have this new adventure of new realities. One totality containing all souls picked up some souls to have a different experience. We are those souls. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here, we'll be there. 90% of our brother-sister souls are sitting there. They never left. we came into these created realities, 10%. And we came here, out of those 10% who came, according to Kabir Anurag Sagar and some other literature that I studied, according to that, what they say is that only very small portion of the souls who came here decided that we may not like the place, like the creation, and how will we come back? So they turned around to their own true self, the totality, and said, what arrangement can we make if we get tired of that to come back? And totality, in which they are a part, they said, no problem. Totality itself can manifest as a human being at any level of your experience and bring you back. This is the kind of story we have, that it's a very small proportion of consciousness that's operating here compared to total consciousness. So the awareness stored in our head, stored in our third eye center, is everything, including our true home. Everything is right there. We have made such an arrangement that although we exist in a physical reality, we are carrying the potential, the possibility of discovering everything in the physical body inside. Of course, physical body itself is a very remarkable piece made up of so many bone tissues, systems, nervous system, other systems. It's very interesting to examine, but to understand the nature of awareness in it, how much awareness you can gather inside it, is even more fantastic. Everything that you can ever imagine existing anywhere exists inside. Everything. All creation exists inside. And we just project it outside to see it here. And nothing is happening outside. There is no outside. Outside is a created thing. And outside has been created because we can get an outside experience. Basic fundamental question is, what was the need for one single totality, one single soul, to become two or three or many in the first place? Forget about these realities. What was the need to have so many souls within the true home, where we say there are millions amongst all within one? Why should there be million trillions of souls sitting there in true home within the one? What is the need to make one into many? The answer is simple. Totality is love. Now mark this word. Totality is love. Not lover. Not beloved. Love. When you make souls separate, you are lovers and beloveds. Love becomes an experience when there is many, and remains love total when there is only one. As a great justification for the many, and therefore the justification for the many existing at all levels of creation, including the physical world. Here, how do we experience love? Between people, between things created here. Something that's created, supposing this was only one, supposing only one being existed in the physical world, no love would have been experienced. Though the nature of our own true self is love. So the many has been created to make some of these things which are innate properties of that one become experiences of that same consciousness. And that is why we are here experiencing what we really are. And it becomes an experience. There is our nature. Here it's an experience. This is a fundamental principle on which the many were created from the one. And goes on till every level. It goes on starting right from within such kind of true home, which is a many. Many are one are simultaneous. For that very thing, one is the innate property, quality of love. Many are experiencing it. Then it goes on to add on more things. The other things added on are to generate different kinds of experiences. Most important addition is the mind. The human mind is a very beautiful device. What does it do? when added on to a soul, when a mind is added on to a soul, what does it do? The soul, as life, as consciousness, begins to use the mind to experience time and space. It doesn't do without it. The mind alone creates the experience of there is time, there is past, present and future. And in the past, there are events that have happened. In the future, more events will be coming. And present, we are going through one event. This is the nature of the mind to create this. And once created, it becomes very easy to generate more experiences by putting those experiences as events on the timeline. Supposing all the events are placed on a timeline with the mind, then we have to connect the events. On what order do we place them? A beautiful principle was evolved. Make the order of events on the timeline as following the principle of cause and effect. Every event that we place on the timeline, place a cause for this earlier than that, on the timeline. A beautiful way to do it. Once having done that, the cause and effect continue all over. From the past, you can see everything was caused by something and the event took place, and more causes creating more events, and then it will go on forever. Time is forever, created forever. The time was created forever. Space is created forever. So within space and time, we are placing all these events. Once we establish the principle of cause and effect, then comes a very interesting feature which makes this creation even more beautiful. We make the cause and effect good or bad. We introduce moral principle. One cause can be good, the effect will be a reward. One cause is bad, effect will be punishment. Reward and punishment gets built into the cause and effect principle that's put on timeline. Once that is done, then we decide what are the punishments, what can be the rewards. That generates a whole series of events now which are based on this is rewarding. You get good health, more money, more success, more things. You become rich. And what are the bad things? You fall sick, you have accidents, you have emotional breakdown, you have this thing. Whole list of events came up. Million, trillion you could be placing on the timeline based on the principle that cause and effect do have a moral side to it. All this is being created by the mind, by the way. His mind does all this. And thus is born the great law of karma. Law of karma is nothing but the implementation of this principle on the timeline. And then the soul, being many souls now, have become the many, are placed in that timeline and given the experiences of generating different patterns on the timeline. One soul can say, I don't like that pattern. I like this one better. Okay, take it. It's also, but oh, I see there's ups and downs in it. Well, it's good to have ups and downs, otherwise how do you enjoy? Or you want to have an adventure. If it's adventure is only one-sided, you'll get nothing. Make it combination. So we pick up, the soul picks up. Now that's the first choice soul ever make. First choice to decide to leave our true home or not, the 10%. Then 1/10 of that 10%, 1% saying we want to come back when we want to. Otherwise everybody will go back on the grand dissolution of the whole show. Everybody goes back. There can be paralaya, dissolution. Nobody is here. Everybody goes away. Mahaparalaya. Even the higher regions are destroyed. True home comes back. And then we start all over again, creating time. This cycle is a great experience. But when you have the karmic pattern based upon cause and effect on the timeline, then you have to generate an experience. So we put on a wonderful costume on top of the mind. A costume that divides perception into touching, tasting, smelling, separate. all five senses separated. They were all together in the mind, in the sense perceptions, and we call it the astral body, the sensory system, and it is covered right on the mind. And now the mind and the soul, providing consciousness, providing life, is operating through another apparatus, creating sense perceptions. And we have a long life there. Each stage has a long life. When the mind was created, it was given a time limit. It doesn't mean that the mind will live as long as the soul. Soul has no limit. Soul is immortal. There is no time. There is no time in such kind. There is no time in the Parabrahm where the soul lives. There is no time in those regions. They are permanent, immortal. But when you put a mind, you gave time to the mind. Mind created time with its own limit. Mind's limit in terms of physical time is said to be between 1 and 3 million years. That means you can have several births in astral plane, in physical plane, several births, and it will be same mind. Mind will not change, senses will change, bodies will change. What is the length of the sensory systems? 1,000 to 3,000 physical years. That means when you die in this physical body, which is very limited, it's 100 years or something, or less than 100 years average, even in good times it will not be more than that, never more than 135 years, you can be rest assured. People think of living a million years in a physical body, won't happen. There will be dissolution before that happens. So when you see that this is such a reduction of time, you can have several physical bodies of different forms, not necessarily human. You can pick up any of the 8.4 million forms of life that exist on the physical plane. Churasilak. That can take you so much time. When you have a change of form, whether body or otherwise, the sense perceptions are still the same that you had in the last life. The mind is still the same that you had in the last life. They go with you for thousands of years. After that, the astral body dies, like the physical dies. You have a new sense perceptions. Mind is still the same. The mind changes in Mahaparala. And that's the several million years takes place before that big change takes place in Parala. So this is the way it is set up like this. Nice stories, right? Whoever has made them was a good storyteller. Not really, because the story that I'm telling you is verifiable through meditation. That's the beauty. Whatever I'm sharing with you, go within yourself, nowhere else, and verify that the different levels I speak of have been generated like that. It's all inside and all verifiable. So it's a very good true story. Even if it is not a true story, still a good story. Somebody, I was at Harvard University as a student. There were some professors, psychologists. They would argue with me. Very simple thing, that the mind can make up all the stories that you are telling. I said, all right, I concede. In fact, I believe that the mind has made up everything. But you are thinking differently. You're thinking the psychology of the brain and the mind working in the brain and limited to the human body. But I think mind created more than that. Anyway, let me accept your proposition that the mind created everything. I said, how did I get this state of happiness by this story? It's a good story and makes me happy. How do you think I became happy? He said, that is called auto-suggestion. You suggested to yourself, there's a higher thing, you have a master, you have this thing, and that's giving you happiness. I said, but you don't believe in that. No, we don't. We are scientists. I said, then tell me a choice if we have to make as human beings, to be happy or to be sad. I said, you are sad. They were on antidepressants, by the way. Because they were so depressed by the fact how they trapped everything in this physical world. And they had no answer, no psychological answer. I said, isn't it wonderful to teach people a method of auto-suggestion that makes them happy forever? What's wrong with it? To that they had no answer. But they said, but don't call it reality. Say it's a method of becoming happy, but then you are fooling yourself into happiness. I said, I fooled myself into happiness. I did wonderful jobs. I got high grades at the Harvard University in my exams. That happiness did not interfere with anything that I was doing in the physical world. How come if I am fooling myself, I should lose some confidence in doing other things? I should be all into my auto-suggestion. Nothing changed. I was the same human being performing the same things in this world which I would have performed if there was no happiness or unhappiness in me because of this spiritual knowledge. So how can you say that this is interfering in anything? If it's not interfering, what's wrong? Let's teach this auto-suggestion to everybody. They really had no answer because everybody is striving for happiness. There's no question about it. Everybody, I have not found people who say, I'm looking for unhappiness. Everybody looking for happiness. One way or the other. Sometimes pleasure gives happiness, sometimes money gives happiness, sometimes physical things give happiness, sometimes internal things give happiness. Everybody is searching for happiness. And if by believing these stories, one can get happy, easiest way. No money is to be spent on this. Go to a perfect living master. I want happiness. He says, okay, follow this path. Believe all I'm going to tell you, you'll see it inside. And I use my mind, begin to see everything inside. My imagination runs riot. I say, I've reached everywhere and I'm happy. Free, free of charge. Happiness being distributed so freely. Why I'm telling you this is because during the course of my personal development on the spiritual path, I was willing to examine every possibility. I was not tied down to any belief system. I said, maybe they're right. If they're right, it's still worthwhile. If they're wrong, it's still worthwhile. So if something is worthwhile, no matter from which point of view you consider, it's something to consider, that's something very useful to give you happiness. Some people have complained to me. Complained. Why are you always happy? I said, what a complaint. They say, you should be normal and unhappy at some time. I said, I try, but I fail. Happiness comes naturally with awareness. That's the truth. When you become aware of the whole show, how it's taking place, you go to see a movie, you come out happy, wonderful, great movie. Movie had ups and downs. But you were not the movie. You were the witness to the movie. The spiritual practice we are talking of makes you witness of the whole show. Not witness of the physical show, witness of every show at every level. Imagine what great happiness to see the grandest of shows possible. No movie has produced so far. The show of life here, the show of life within, show of life in true home. If you can see that, it gives you happiness nothing can give anywhere else. And you are happy all the time, 24/7, here and elsewhere. So what's wrong with it? So that is why when these people want to argue with me, I'm willing to argue. I'm willing to tell them, yes, this is something that will give you happiness, true happiness. True happiness when you discover you are a witness. You are not the actor. You are seeing the acting. But you were a very clever witness. When we are sitting in a movie theater, we are sitting away from the screen. Everything happens on the screen and we think is real. We are so convinced it is real, we laugh and cry as if it is real. I must tell you, I cry when I watch movies. I don't cry otherwise in life. Movies look more real to me. And my children, when they are accompanying me to a movie, they carry extra handkerchief for me. I say, hold my tears. Where is the difference? I say, that's a movie, this is a movie, there's no difference. Anyway, the point I'm making is that we take it as real. Why? We spend money to go and see horror, murders taking place, betrayals taking place, terrible things happening in the movie, and we pay for it to watch it. This same things happen in life. Why are we not happy to see? Why don't we pay for seeing this movie? Because we don't take it as movie. We take it as our reality. That what is the truth? The truth is, this is the same movie like the movie on the screen. One difference, instead of watching from an audience seat away from the screen, you have decided to place yourself inside the head of one of the characters in the movie. That's the only difference. You just decided to be so close to the action, so close to the movie, you place yourself in the head of one character in the movie. It didn't matter what character. Sometimes people say, if this is true, I could have placed myself in the character of a king or placed something better, rich man. Why did I become poor? Why did I pick up such a wrong character to sit inside and become that character? The answer to this question was given in a book that I read long ago called The Canterbury Tales by Geoffrey Chaucer. That's an interesting book. In that book, there are 40-50 pilgrims in England traveling to a holy place in Canterbury. And since there was no fast transport in those days, they are mostly walking, some are on horseback, some are on a carriage, and they are going slowly. It takes many days to reach their destination. To pass the time, on the way, they tell stories to each other, they sing songs to each other, they tell poems to each other. This book is considered in English literature to be the father, the originator of the English novel. Because before this book was published and written, all stories were, once upon a time there was a king and he did this. Nobody said he was a jealous king, generous king, what kind of king. There was no characterization. This is the first time characterization started. It's a very important book that way, in literature. But in the book, they describe the different characters, and the characterization is such that they apply even today. For example, they describe an attorney, a lawyer. And in that poem, in the poetic description of the lawyer, Chaucer says, a busier man than him there nos me never was. A busier man than him there never was, and yet he seemed busier than he was. And to look through our modern day attorney. And similarly, all of the characters are described with a characterization which now leads to the most modern novels and movies. That book was important. But the point I was going to make was, these 50 pilgrims going to Canterbury are entertaining each other. The book is written by Geoffrey Chaucer, but he says he was also amongst them. Geoffrey Chaucer was also amongst those 50 people. And at one point in the story, they said, Chaucer, you come up with some nice poem. And he says, I don't know how to make poem. He's made the poem that every other character has spoken. And yet as a character, he says, I don't know how to make a poem. I'm not a poet. They say, no, come on, we know you are an author. They even know that. We know you're an author, you need books and poetry. Come on, come up with something. And then Chaucer comes up with the worst doggerel rhyme in the whole book. The worst poem is that which he speaks. And they all criticize him. Oh, we expected something better. Who's written this? Chaucer himself. Question has been asked, why did Chaucer put himself in a story in the worst character? He could have been the best character if he wanted to. Why did he put himself in the worst character? Some people in theology have compared this book to the life of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ was one with the Father, the creator of all universe, and how can he be crucified by his own creation? Like Chaucer was crucified by his own creation in the book. How could that be? Answer in both cases is the same. Chaucer was the author of all the characters. He was all characters. He could choose to put himself in anyone. He was still the author of all characters. And he knew it. The creator He created all beings. If he put himself in one form, Jesus, and got crucified, he was still all beings. That is the whole purpose. It does not matter in which character you place yourself when you know you are the author of the whole show. That is why when we come into this world and we become witnesses by sitting in a character, it doesn't matter at all which character we sit in, because we are all characters. And that is why when we see this drama, if you think you are the character, then you have a hard time. You are poor, you suffer. If you are rich, you enjoy. If you are sick, then you are suffering. But if you are a witness, it's the character going through these things, not you. You're just watching it, like you watch a movie. And you enjoy it, and you are happy. You are happy no matter what, because the show is so interesting overall. And when you see many shows at different levels of consciousness, you enjoy even more. And that is happiness unbounded. If I were to give a shortcut to how to have a minimum experience of this, without going deep into meditation or anything, I can suggest a simple thing. For a few days, imagine you are not the person the body is called by. That's not your name, that's the name of your body. You are sitting inside in a comfortable chair watching the show in which you are also a character, all others are characters. Try for 1 week. Look at this. You'll be so happy, you won't even believe it. You can try it. Unhappiness and suffering comes when you identify yourself with a character who has been created by you. And the same thing is true at every level of creation. Ultimately, it's the creative power itself that's manifesting in all characters. And once you get that awareness, that realization, the whole thing becomes what it is, a show. A big drama created for experience, for a different experience. Every level creates a different experience. Every situation in space and time, at every level creates different experiences. To have a series of experiences, that is what the whole purpose of creation is. Whole purpose of being here. And we are very lucky individuals who have souls that made an arrangement to go back. None of you would be sitting here, I can tell you, if you had not made that arrangement. Because you are sitting here as seekers of the truth, the same truth I am seeking. We are co-travelers. We are co-travelers on the same path. And that is why I feel so happy that we are all traveling together to the same destination. Some of you may have been initiated by a perfect living master. Some of you are still waiting to be initiated. Some of you have still doubts about initiation and about masters. Doesn't matter. They're all different stages. It doesn't matter. When you look at the millions of years through which the mind is operating, and we are talking of a few years here, it's a very small time. Some people say, we want to go back to our true home ASAP. I get a lot of requests like that. ASAP. I said, in such kind, a million billion years is ASAP. And then there was told a story by somebody that a man found out that Brahma, the creator of the universe, his time is different from ours, and so things are at a different scale. So he prayed to Brahma. He said, Brahma, is it true that 1,000 years here is like a moment for you? He said, that is true. Is it also true that $1,000,000 here is just a cent or a penny for you? He said, that is true. Can I have a penny? And Brahma said, wait a minute. So, in nice, interesting stories they make to show the nature of time and our expectancies. When you look at this whole life, or 20 lifetimes, it's like a moment in such kind. And it is very different. You notice that when we go to sleep and have a dream, the flow of time is very different from the flow of time here. In 1962, I came to the United States as a student. And at that time, there were a lot of experiments going on sleeps and dreams. I was interested in that because in India I read books on dream interpretation, what dreams mean. And I wanted to see if they really relate to what they are studying here. Here they were studying actual dreams and made people dream, and they put on different kind of gadgets on them, to cameras in front to see the rapid eye movement and other kind of electrodes and things to study their vital signs, their movements. Camera would take movements when you are dreaming, what kind of body movements you still have. A lot of study was done. I joined them. I joined that course to study with them. And they studied that the time frame that is created in a dream is very different from the time frame in real life, physical life. For example, they would wake up a person in the middle of the sleep when they saw rapid eye movement, that means there's a dream going on, and ask, what are you seeing? And the person would tell exactly what's happening and then go back to sleep. When that person woke up finally, never remembered there was a dream at all. He said, I never have a dream. Every person they found dreams several times a night, every person. But most people say we never have dreams. They don't remember any dreams. The fading of a dream sequence is so fast. Today, the average fade-off period when you get up, a dream, you remember some part of it, but it fades within 30 seconds. You can't remember. If it's a traumatic dream, you can remember. But otherwise, dreams are forgotten every night. We have several dreams. Average dream lasts only 7 to 11 minutes. And then you are in deeper sleep and not dreaming, not having any rapid eye movement. One guy who was dreaming, dreamt that he was going to school as a child. He remembered his old childhood. Going to school as a child, he met a girl, he fell in love with her. They grew up, they went to church, they got married, they had children, and he got very old, he had grandchildren. And then when he was going to die, he suddenly woke up. He lived his whole life. It all took place in 7 minutes of physical time. So when so much time can be generated, in 7 minutes you can have a whole lifetime. You can imagine what level of awareness can do. By going to a lower level, you generate an immense amount of time. Somebody recommended I see a movie, I think it's called Inception. Some of you might have seen. In that also they show, when a person goes to sleep and dreams, the dream sequence is large. 10 minutes of wakeful time become several hours. Dream within a dream becomes a whole lifetime. And they also have a strange system by which they have something holding in the hand by which they can wake up. And which is very similar to our situation, that when we want to wake up from the dream sequences, a perfect living master appears, which we have arranged before we came into this place. And that is very similar. So the movie impressed me for these two features it had, that the dream and dream within dream increases a lifetime of space and time, and wakefulness is very small time. Similarly, the wakefulness in our case is zero time and zero space, ultimate wakefulness. The whole thing is created by dream sequences, which we call different levels of consciousness, different worlds that we have created. I am sharing this information with you because it's all verifiable. It's not verifiable, still a good story. Still a good story to take advantage of. Sometimes we read stories and feel happy. If you can feel happy by sitting in the head and saying this is a drama I'm watching, if you can really do it, if you can do that, which is easy if you do meditation regularly, by the way. If you meditate regularly and place yourself at third eye center regularly, it becomes very easy for you to know, I am sitting there. The name I am called by is not my name. I have a different name because I had a different name in my past life. Sitting there long enough can also tell you your past lives. If you can withdraw attention from the physical body, from the physical world, you can remember your past lives. Don't have to go to these people who say, we'll give you past life regressions. I went to a gypsy sitting in some place in Florida or somewhere. A friend took me and they were asking what we were in past lives. Gypsy would look at them, oh, you were Cleopatra, Oh, you were king so and so. I said, was anybody poor in the last life? Nobody. Now, those stories are pleasing for people. It's nice if you are pleased by that story. So if you can be pleased by a gypsy story, you can also be pleased by a story told by these spiritual masters, if they are only stories. But since the experience can be replicated within yourself, that is why it becomes very joyful, very happiness-giving to go through the experience. Just sit at the third eye center where you already are. When we say sit at the third eye center, it only means imagining you are there. You are already there, but you are scattered. Attention is scattered and therefore you are all over. Attention, when you sit and imagine you are there and concentrate on being there, knowing what is happening there, you are only pulling that attention back to where it is. You will also find, in the beginning people find when they meditate, a lot of things pull them out. Things that they have forgotten suddenly get remembered. Sometimes somebody said, I lost my keys, I couldn't find. I said, meditate. The mind will pick up the keys before it goes inside. The mind wants to keep you out, but your soul wants to go in. There's always a conflict between the soul and the mind. And you can work some nice drama. But the starting point is, spend some time concentrating on where you are actually operating from in the physical body, which is the head behind the eyes. Spend some time on it every day and see your life change. Life will change outside because you are creating it. If you sit there, you will change, have the ability to change life outside also. You may or may not choose to change because you will say, good drama going on, why should I change it? That's what ultimately happens. But at least you'll feel it's your show and you are just watching from the right place behind the eyes. Thank you very much for spending time with me. I don't know. Is there any questions? Do we have any questions from yesterday left over? Okay, let me take up a few questions. I sometimes treat these questions as a subject for a new talk. You must have noticed that. But no, not, sometimes I can give short answers. But this is just to share what I feel about it based on the experience with this great master. This has been the biggest thing could ever happen, to experience the love of the great master. There is nothing like it. Nothing exists anywhere at any level that I could see. Such unconditional love. Non-judgmental, no judging. A person came to great master and said, Master, forgive me. You told me not to eat meat, not to drink alcohol, not to lead an immoral life like womanizing. I did all three last night. I was in bad company. Master, forgive me. Great Master said, okay, you are forgiven. He said, thank you, thank you, thank you, and he ran away. Master's own secretaries are sitting there, educated. One was a judge, one was a professor. They were all sitting around him. And they looked up and said, Master, this boy has disobeyed your instructions. And instead of punishing him for that, you said, okay, you are forgiven. Supposing he does the same things again and comes to you, will you still forgive him? He said, I think I will still forgive him. Because he's asked for forgiveness. Master, if you keep on doing that, you will keep on forgiving him. I think I'll keep on forgiving him. Master, when will you punish him? He said, look, these are the great master's words. He said, look, his mind is punishing him more than is necessary. He's running to me for forgiveness. His mind is punishing him. He's punishing himself enough. Don't put me amongst punishers. Let me remain in the category of forgivers. And he kept that standard always. Forgiver. Perfectly living masters are always forgivers, not punishers. Negative powers exist all around us, including our own mind, to punish us all the time. We are punished by these negative forces all the time. A perfectly living master doesn't come to punish us further. He comes to forgive. And that is why it's a characteristic of these perfect living masters, they always forgive. So it's a great experience to be in the company of such a person. Great experience to be around these perfect living masters. If one gets a chance in life to be around such people, spend as much time as you can with these people. An American disciple, a great master, asked him, how often should we come and have your darshan to see you? He says, ideally, you should see me every morning. He said, Master, if somebody is not living here with you, how can he come every morning? He says, then once a week is good enough. And when Master said this, my grandfather, who became a believer after my father did, but my grandfather happened to be sitting there. And he said, if you are living in another town nearby, once a week is good enough. From that date, my grandfather went every weekend till he died because of the words of great master. He said, but the American disciple said, Master, somebody living very far off. He said, then once a month is okay. Master, what about us who live in other countries? Once a year is good enough. He said, Master, supposing some cannot afford to come or cannot come in once a year, then what's the frequency? So Master smiled. He said, then you can wait for another life. Next life will also come. So that is why to have the company of these masters is so important. It changes us. Every time we spend time with them, something happens to us and changes us. So that is why we should spend as much time as we can and afford to be with these people who come for us, really. They are here for us, these perfect living masters. Okay, let's take up a couple of questions.
You said physical world and master is illusion. What about initiation by perfect living master? Is it real or illusion?
You said physical world and master is illusion. I now say all creation is illusion. Not only physical world, astral world, causal world, souls, all illusion. Such kind of illusion. What's reality then? Everything we ever talk of is included in the statement. Then what is real? The experiencer of this illusion is real. The self is real. The experiencer of the physical world, no matter whether placed in one character or the other, is real. Absolutely real. The experiencer of the astral world is real. The experiencer of the causal world is real. Causal world is not. The experiencer of such kind is real. Such kind is not. The self is real. The consciousness is real. Everything is illusion created by consciousness. Therefore, if you want to understand true reality, one can apply a simple definition. What changes cannot be real. If it changes, how can it be real? It should be reality, it should be permanent. Everything changes. This world changes. It's destroyed by parallel, grand dissolutions. Everything is destroyed. All experiences are changing. Experiencer never changes. The self never changes. The one that sees the dream is the same self. The one that's awaking, same self. The one that watches the astral plane, same self. Go to causal plane, same self. Go to be a soul, same self. Go to totality, is the same totality, the same self. Self alone is real. Everything else is illusion. What about initiation by perfect living master? Is it real or illusion? That is real. Now, how can that be? It's real because it's a connection between the self which is real and given to the self which is the real. Initiation is not given to the body. It's not given to the senses. It's not given to the mind. It's given to the self, consciousness itself. And consciousness is real, self is real, that's where initiation takes place. Initiation is not for any other part of the body or experience. It's not given to the created world, it's given to the self experiencing the created world. So that is why the initiation by a perfect master touches the self. love that we experience touches the soul. That's real because we are real as a self. So that is why, remember, it's experiencer, not the experience. That's real. And initiation is something that happens to the real self, not anywhere else. When masters come and pull us through initiation, they are pulling our soul, our self, reality, into its wakeful state of totality, which is the master himself. So that is why master is an example of our own reality. We have projected out all this reality as an illusion outside, including a master, including his initiating, but he is doing something created outside for the self, which is real. So that's why it becomes real.
Please speak about when there is no other awareness but of beyond formlessness, beyond even love.
Please speak about when there is no other awareness but of beyond formlessness, beyond even love. Some people might have experienced that, a beyond that is beyond love. I haven't. I found when you go beyond all experiences, love still stays. Ultimate love. A love from which all love is born. A love the replication of which goes on at every level of creation and including the attachments we have is a gross form of the same love which is our reality. So as we go beyond these things, beyond mind, beyond maya, beyond the surfaces of what is around us, love still stays. Love is a characteristic of the one totality, and therefore love stays all the time. But you can have experiences earlier when you seem to go into a void. That comes in meditation and comes in many kinds of meditation, which I have myself experienced, that you can do many kinds of yogas and concentration, and you can create a void as if nothing exists, but you exist even then. Otherwise, who is experiencing the void? The self continues to exist at all times, no matter what. A void can be created where nothing else exists except the self. It can come as an experience. During yoga and others, it can come. But that is not giving you any higher awareness. It's an awareness that comes by blocking for temporary time the awarenesses of things around you, and some yogas are available for doing that. Love never goes away.
We want to make the choice that brings us closer to the master, but the mind is so devious, I am afraid the choice will be the opposite of what you want.
We want to make the choice that brings us closer to the master, but the mind is so devious, I'm afraid the choice will be the opposite of what you want. That's true. We have no enemy in this world. The enemy that doesn't want us to do what we really soul want to do is sitting inside us, our own mind. There is no obstacle between us and our true home except the mind. The mind was created so we can have an independent experience of creation, shut off from our own reality, shut off from our own experience of the true reality. The mind was created as a wall in which the show is taking place this side, and the mind doesn't want you to go. It's a wall. To cross that wall is not easy at all. Mind can never cross. Mind never wants to cross. That's true. What you have written here is true. The mind does not want to cross the wall and go there. That is why it's the master operating from the other side of the wall who pulls with love and tells us that I can take you above by invisible ladder. There was a one Swami, he came and he said, the biggest mistake is to try to break a wall. He said, people try that all the time. Oh, this is an obstacle coming in my way, and they break their own head. And then what happens if they break the wall, They are lying there, injured, and other people walk over them and cross them. He said, what kind of action is that, to break a wall? No, don't break a wall. Go around the wall, go along the wall. No wall is permanent, and you cross it. He was trying to deal with the problem that we suffer in life and how to deal with problems. Don't break your wall. Don't break yourself trying to solve a problem. Go around the problem, you'll find a way. So give you an example of the wall. The mind is blocking us. Nothing else is. Nothing else. The rest is experience. Our internal mind is blocking us by saying, stay this side, stay this side. There was a king. He had an army, but the army was not having any war. King was a very peaceful man. Since he said the army will have no training, he decided to split the army into red army and blue army. And for practice, they will fight with each other. But when people will see, they will feel there's a real battle going on in our own towns and our places. So therefore, he built a wall, a huge wall, circular wall, and told the armies to practice their battle under the hiding inside that wall. But the wall, unfortunately, was not made of bricks or something. It was made by wooden planks. So what happened when the war started inside, the sound of the war attracted people. And they ran, and the little chinks that were left between the planks of the wood, they put their eyes there and watched the war inside, thinking real war going on. Children were there. They were not coming. Their mothers called, come, lunch is ready, come. No, wait, wait. They were so glued to seeing the drama going on, which was all artificial, drama going on, which they took as real, and they wouldn't even listen to the voice of their mother or father. And the person who gave me the description said, this is our description. The wall is of the mind. And we are stuck into the little chinks by these eyes looking inside the created world of the mind. And father and mother are calling us inside. Come in, come in. Wait, this is too interesting here. I have to stay here. I have to do my job. I have to do this. I love these people. How can I leave them? Everything is here around, built with that wall of the mind. So that is why the mind is the problem. And people can't control. One great sage, he said, if somebody came and told me that he has picked up the whole Himalayan mountain, I know it's not possible. I still believe it for a moment. Such a person can come, who can pick up a whole mountain. If somebody came and say he had drunk the water of the whole ocean, it's impossible. But I believe that there might be such a person. But if somebody comes and tells me he has controlled his mind, I'll say never, never, never. He puts the control of the mind even more difficult than that. He says mind is very difficult to control. And really speaking, we have identified ourselves with the mind. We don't think there's a mind. We think there's ourselves. When we think, we say, I think so. I think so. The I, which is the I of the mind, is being equated with our own self. That's the biggest trap, that there's no distinction left between the mind. The truth is, we should know the self is using the mind to create an I, to do business here, to do work here, to live life here. The self is using a mind to think. Self is using the mind to rationalize. The self is using the mind to make sense of the three worlds out here. That's how it should be. If we meditate regularly, that will be our state. We will know we are using our mind. Now what is happening? Mind is using us. We are slaves of the mind. Mind is telling us what to do. So the questioner is right. The mind tries to take us in the opposite direction all the time. And the solution is more meditation. More meditation. Fight with the mind. Now, some people have come back to me after I told them fight with the mind. They had a very sad experience fighting with the mind. Because every time they tried to meditate, the mind would take them to something else. And they would fight, no, I won't go with you. And they put their attention back. Mind took another direction. They fought back. After 2.5 hours, they got so tired, they lost the war. They won every battle and lost the war. That's what the mind is. Fighting with the mind is not easy. I have to tell you, the way to fight the mind is not to go with the mind and do what the mind is doing or do something opposite to what the mind is doing. Ignore what the mind is doing. Allow the mind to think. In real meditation, you will find you can place yourself there. Mind thinks, you think, I am doing something else. If you have altercation with the mind, you are involved. That's what mind likes. Mind likes that you just get altercation with the mind and you are tired at the end of the meditation, nothing achieved. Ignore the mind. Ignoring the mind is the best way of fighting the mind. So when you ignore the mind, it becomes easier if you remember your master, if you remember the love of your master, if you sit inside and talk to your master and remember the thing that happened. When you think of that, the mind squirms around, but the love is more powerful than the thought of the mind. You can try it out. So love and devotion, which they say is the essence of true meditation, helps you to take care of the mind.
What if you don't want to meditate? What if you know there is higher truth, but you don't feel compelled to seek it?
What if you don't want to meditate? What if you know there is higher truth, but you don't feel compelled to seek it? That's fine, wonderful. Enjoy. You know, it's not compulsory. Nothing mandatory that you have to do it. And meditation is a choice. You don't want to make a choice, don't. Enjoy. If you don't enjoy and then say, oh, I am very unhappy, then meditate.
This problem may be age-related, but lately I feel a lot of anxiety when I hear masters talk about how the soul is separated from God and have been wandering in Chaurasi ages upon ages. I have no recollection of the true home. It is a concept that is far from my current experience of reality. Even to contemplate the vast and incomprehensible creation as outlined by the masters overwhelms me. Furthermore, when I sit to meditate, I am actually afraid to step forward into that unknown world.
Is it a question or an answer?
I think it's a question.
I read it again. This problem may be age related, but lately I feel a lot of anxiety when I hear masters talk about how the soul separated from God and have been wandering in the Chaurasi ages after ages. I have no recollection of the true home. It's a concept that is far from my current experience of reality. Even to contemplate the vast and incomprehensible creation as outlined by the masters overwhelms me. Furthermore, when I sit to meditate, I am actually afraid to step forward to that unknown world. Many of us feel that way. It's true, because it's ingrained in us to take this reality as the only reality. It is built like that. The system is created, the creation is system. So any level in which we are should look like the only reality. It's not by accident this is happening. It's designed like this. That is why our only reality is this reality. Nothing else. If we find another reality, it can come. But right now, only reality. If this was not the only reality, masters have no role here at all. We look for them in another reality. Masters are physical beings like us. They appear to us in the physical reality. They work with us in the physical reality. They ask us to meditate in the physical reality. They ask us to work with these bodies we have, which are physical realities. Therefore, the whole operation of the spiritual path takes place at physical reality. It is not necessary to be overwhelmed by anything. Just follow what is happening within the physical reality. When you go to see a master and see him, which is called having darshan of a master, It's physical reality. Affects you physically, affects your physical life, maybe also affecting other lives. But don't be carried away by any messages of pastors about other places when our reality is here. The master is appearing here in the same form as we are. Spend your time in this physical reality, the best you can get while you are in the physical reality, which is meet a physical master. Spend time with a physical master. The other inner master will come when it comes. Physical master is here. That is why it's so important to spend time as much as we can in this physical reality with a physical form of a master. I was once asking great master, Master, when I will see you one day in your radiant form inside in meditation, then will there be a need to see you here also? Because I found the real one. Won't I know that you are unreal and the other one I saw inside meditation is real? Master laughed and he said, No, because this question you are asking me is to a physical master like me. When you will be there, you will be talking to that master, but then you will come back here in physical reality. I'll still be here, the physical master, not that one. Great point he made, that we are at one level of reality and all reality is within that level. We say the self is there up in a higher term. It's not another place. Supposing our true home was far away, I could understand our anxiety. We are in the true home. We don't have to go anywhere. Spiritual journey is not a journey. It's a removing of walls of illusion and finding out that we were always in the true home. There's no anxiety at all. We just created these illusions to have a different type of experience, one over after the other. And we have now a choice to go back the same way, in the same spot. Somebody sent me a nice song sung by a Pakistani singer. It was in Multani language called Ith Nahi Te Kith Nahi. If it is not here, it's nowhere. Everything we're talking of is here, now, within. Everything, including true home. Nothing to worry, nothing to be anxious about. Act with the reality in which you are placed. Thank God that the totality of creation, God Himself, who may be in heaven somewhere, we don't know where He is actually sitting right inside us, right where we are, and appears in the form of a perfect living master with the same awareness that ultimately any theoretical God can ever have, in physical form. That is why, no anxiety. Get the best out of your physical experience that you have been chosen to be called by the love of a perfect living master. Very lucky souls. Very most lucky souls. And spend as much time as you can. The company of the master. Learn what you can. Meditate as much as you can. But meditation is a means to reach up to a certain point only. Meditation does not take you to Sachkhand. Meditation, which is an effort you make, can take you only up to the level of the mind. Love of the master will take you everywhere. If you feel the pull of the love of a master, meditation will be natural for you. Wherever you remember master because he loves you, is meditation. You meditate upon the master, is good meditation. Whether you repeat words or not, they are meant for some other purpose. But the love of a master, to remember the master, is the best meditation you can do. So that is why, spend time, use the physical reality, and don't have any anxiety whatsoever.
Is it safe for initiates of Santamat to practice pranayama for health reasons?
Is it safe for initiates of Santamat to practice pranayama for health reasons? Absolutely safe. There's no connection between the two. If you are using pranayama, breathing exercises to improve your health, nothing to do with this raising your awareness. Don't use it as a spiritual practice, but use it for health is good. Anything you do for health is good and doesn't interfere with your raising your awareness through meditation. So meditate at the third eye center. If The pranayama says that you will achieve your ultimate goal by breathing. Don't be mistaken. Read the original literature about pranayama. Pran means life. Pran does not mean breathing. They say his pran has gone. Not that breathing is gone, life is gone. Pran is life. Pranayama is controlling life. It was to be controlled with the various possibilities in the human body. Six centers of the energy, 12 centers of the awareness constitutes life available to us here. By putting attention on these, we can control life, we can control prana. This was the idea. But when they began to say that prana is breathing, we thought mere act of breathing differently is going to give us enlightenment. It does not. I want to meet somebody. I've done that myself. A lot of breathing exercise I did as pranayama. And then I studied that what are Patanjali and other authors of these things saying? They are calling as the pran or the life. Pranayama is controlling life, not controlling breathing. But if you want to do breathing exercises and all to maintain your health, very good. Do it.
In the Rice Lake Retreat, you mentioned that one can listen to the left side sound for practice. Baba Sawan Singh has mentioned categorically that by left side sound is from Kaal, negative power, and not to pay any attention to it. In Spiritual Gems and Dawn of Light, could you please explain this and elaborate on it to clear our confusion? In the second part. Also, while practicing on the physical sound, there is a possibility of developing tinnitus, a medical condition. Can you please advise as to how to avoid tinnitus while trying to get to the real sound?
You read the second side also. I see it all in one side. Okay, let me read it. In Rice Lake Retreat, you mentioned that the one can listen to the left side air for practice. Baba Sawan Singh has mentioned categorically that the left side sound is from Kaal, negative power, and not to pay any attention to it. In Spiritual Gems and Dawn of Light, can you please explain his and elaborate on it to clear our confusion? Also, while practicing on the physical sound, there is a possibility of developing tinnitus, medical condition. Can you please advise as to how to avoid tinnitus while trying to get to the real sound? Good question, very practical question, and a lot of people have asked me about this. What is the sound that we want to hear? What has sound to do with meditation? We want to put our attention on third eye center. What has sound to do with it? I hinted yesterday that everything is sound right up to the top. I talked of spoken sound, varanatmak shabd, and the musical sound, dhonatmak shabd, the higher sound, which is no beginning, no end. They call it by the om sound, which is anhat shabd. There's real sar shabd, which is the soul, and sat shabd, which is totality. It's all called sound or word. Why is that? Reason is simple. The self is consciousness and wants to be conscious of things, which is called experience. Can the self experience itself? Or does it have to have something around it? Is there something happening within the self at any level where it can experience itself with no creation outside of itself? Yes, it can. It can't be described how that experience is above the mind. It's indescribable. To experience the self as a self is indescribable in any language that I know of. But below that, it can be expressed as sound. In the physical plane where we operate and where the instructions are given to us, it appears as genuine sound coming from the self, not from anywhere else. Sounds come from all over. We hear other people talk, we hear music, we hear so on, all sounds coming from outside. We have ears to hear. There's sound within the body that we keep on happening. We can hear our own heartbeat sometimes. We can hear our breathing. We can hear blood flowing if you are in deep meditation or in deep yoga positions. So many sounds can be heard which can be explained as physical sounds. But there is a sound that is not physical, but comes from the self. The awakened self that creates the physical world emanates a sound. And that's the sound, if you happen to listen to that sound, and who listens? The self. The self listens to its own sound, and that brings your attention faster to itself. That sound comes from where you are. It comes from the third eye center, where you are sitting in the wakeful state, where you start your meditation. When you meditate, if you concentrate there, sound will come from within yourself. Not from the side, not left, right, up or down. It will be within yourself. Sometimes it will look like it's coming from above, below, like this. But mostly it will be exactly where you are. It will be like a surround sound. It's all around you. The closer you get to yourself, the greater the sound will be. And for easy recognition, you will also know in the beginning, the sound will be like a big bell. A big bell when you hear the church. That's why they put up the big bells in the temples, churches, all bells are rung everywhere. It is a copy. It's an indication of the real sound coming from the self inside. And it's sound which can be heard. That is why they say our consciousness is audible life stream. Audible means it can be heard. So we hear the sound from within ourselves. No connection with left, right or anywhere. Then where is the question of hearing from the left ear, right ear? It's only when you don't hear the sound. Your attention is completely outside. And for practice, you want to hear any sound. And breathing was also used as one sound, but it kept the attention a little lower. So you'd pull it up later in higher at the Agni Chakra or at the third eye center. Sound has been a principle. The real sound is only one and comes from the self as a third eye center in the center, not from any side. Till you hear that sound, you can hear any sound inside. For practice, it will not lead you anywhere. It won't have any pull. It won't bring you toward yourself. Just for practice that we can hear a sound. If you can only hear a sound from the left ear and nowhere else, hear that sound to start with. Or just practice of listening to a sound. It does not mean that that sound is going to do anything for you. If you can hear sound from both sides, then listen to the right side and not the left. And why is that? Because we are operating with our mind in the physical brain. The brain itself is divided into the right and left lobes. And as you know, one lobe is intuitive, one lobe is reasoning. Reasoning lobe is called kal, negative, and the intuitive lobe is called positive, dhyal. Kal and dhyal are a division of how the mind operates in the brain. And that is why the right side picks up the intuitive self, which is our own true self. So the two things that are happening, right side is recommended for that reason. It does not mean listening to right side will give you a knowledge of the self. You have to come to the center. I've met people who listening to the right sound for years and years, nothing happened. Their attention is on the right, not in the center at all. It doesn't help. When you divide it to left and right, it's only for the sake of practice. Both sides is practice. Great Master explained very clearly. And the real sound comes from the center. These are for practice. But if you are hearing both sounds, listen to the right. And we are confusing and thinking the right side is the side that will give us some inner enlightenment. It doesn't. Side, right, left side doesn't give enlightenment. Middle side sound will give enlightenment. If you start listening to sounds, you will find you have a choice. Sound will start coming with meditation. The more you concentrate being in the head, the more your sounds can be heard, some far away, some nearby. These sounds which come from the right and left side look like they're coming from very near us. There is something very near, maybe in the head or very close. That sound is very dim, like it's the bell is sounding very far away. It doesn't look like it's right here. You can't determine which side it is. You try to say, where's the bell from this side? Maybe this side, no. Up, it's surrounding you. It's very weak to start with because your attention is not there. As you gather more attention, that sound can become louder. You have a choice to put your attention on any sound you like. In good meditation, in practical meditation, you should play around, listening to one sound, another sound, and saying, which is the one that is pulling me, which is resembling the sound of the big bell. Also, when you hear the big bell, you'll first hear, ong, ong, like a bell. Then the peal will increase, ong, go longer. Then it'll only be the peal and no hit at all. So this is how a change takes place in the sound. And that is a longer sound, which has no peal left, no hit left, is what will take you to the next level of awareness. So sound plays a very important role, but don't get confused. This was only a suggestion. If you can't hear any sound, only the left, you can begin from there, and it is not going to help you, but it will help you to start listening, and then when the middle sound comes, you'll be able to hear. But first both sounds will come, then shift over to the right. It's just because of the placing of our life force at this time in the brain functioning like that. So no worry about it. Just for practice, do that. Real sound will only be in the center.
Two questions, both this similar. Why do pundits love rice pudding here?
Also about rice pudding.
Oh, pour that together. Master, why do pundits love rice pudding here? I think because it's tasty. It's a dessert. There was a pandit, a priest, and they are invited to the homes of people. They give blessing, they read mantras, and they do various kind of religious practices. So once a pandit took his son there to the feast. When rice was served, as usual, at the end, the pandit was eating his rice and he saw his son take a little rice and then picked up a glass of water and drink it. He said, I have to take care of this guy. So when the feast was over, they went out, he slapped his son. Don't you know that by drinking water, you are putting water instead of kheer into your stomach? That time for kheer, not for water. The son said, Dad, you don't know that when I put water, it creates this, settles this kheer. I could eat more kheer. He slapped him again. Why didn't you tell me? It's just an old tradition, because what used to happen, when we went to the temples in India and met the priests, we normally like to give donations. Money came much later. Donations were there long before money ever was issued. So the donations used to be in the form of grain or other kinds of mostly food. Wheat and rice became popular. And in North India, the main staple was wheat. Rice was supposed to be luxury, and rice was given a donation to the priest. In South India, it was different. There, rice was the main staple. So there was a different practice amongst the priests in the different areas of the country. But rice was a very common offering. And the use of rice was mainly to sweeten it and make it kheer, better than just boiling and eating it like a staple. So the concept of a kheer or rice pudding came early on, way before this happened, and the priests were willing to accept rice. Ultimately, they would taste rice. They became accustomed to enjoying rice pudding, and they still enjoy even today. And some of us also enjoy rice pudding, but we don't become priests by that. Thank God. Okay, any more questions? One more.
Is it possible to talk to the master with your eyes open in this reality, but still at the same time visualize him internally, like at work, etc.?
Thank you.
Is it possible to talk to the master with your eyes open on this reality, but still at the same time visualize him internally. Yes, it is possible. It is possible to do meditation with your eyes open. With practice, you have to put attention inside, not necessarily closing your eyes. Closing eyes is because our attention automatically gets pulled out when our eyes are open. Closing eyes is only for that, to avoid distraction. Closing ears is only to avoid distraction. But if you are used to pulling attention, I took some couple of friends of American friends to the Dera once to introduce them to a BB Lajo. And we asked this question, can you meditate with eyes open? She said, of course I do that all the time. And she meditated with eyes open. We knew she was not licking. We could see from her face. So my friend said, bring my movie camera. You know, Americans were very keen to take a movie of everything. It's a video. So he took out his movie camera and watched her meditating with eyes open. And it was very good. It's complete then. He said, now I have a record of it. We came back, he played the record. He could see nothing on it except flickering of light. He said, I couldn't even catch it. He said, she was in deep meditation. And you cameras can't catch it. It has happened many times, I've seen, that cameras fail to capture some of these things where one's consciousness is not at the physical level, even in the physical body. So you can not only visualize, talk to the master, fly with the master, your eyes open. But it needs little practice that you're not distracted by what is in front of the eyes. Okay, thank you very much for joining me, and have a nice lunch break, and I'll see you at 3 o'clock again.